Everybody, welcome back. I am KRX, and we are playing as Portugal as part of this beginner's guide to Europa Universalis 4. And we are playing without the DLC. It is important to kind of remember that, you know, this is a guide specifically, you know, targeted to the people who are just getting the game for, you know, $8 or $10 when it goes on sale regularly. And maybe they're not picking up the DLC. Maybe they just want to try it before they get the DLC. That makes a lot of sense, right? That makes a lot of sense. This game does have a lot of DLC that affects the core systems of the game, so it is actually kind of a good perspective for me to also go back and kind of play the game 7 years after it came out without any of the DLC content to get a good sense of kind of where the game, what the state of the game is these days. What I realized is we had just gone to war with Morocco, right? And we called in Castile and we ended up winning that war and we ended up getting some new pieces of land. We kind of hit those buttons kind of fast. I'm not going to lie, guys. If anybody's thinking, what the heck was going on last episode, the episode before that, I think I've been getting... There's just so much information to talk about. It's like, on one sense, we haven't really done that much. We've only progressed 13 years in the game in, you know, 5 hours of playing or whatever, right? We haven't really actually moved that quickly. But at the same time, like, there's so many things going on. There's so many systems that we're covering that it actually feels like it's like, whoa, 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 Carex, you know, let's go a little slower there. So I think we're going to actually try to use today as a way to kind of reassess things and take a look at things and sort of slow things down just a touch. Let's just slow things down a touch. Let's now that we've won the war against Morocco, Castile was fighting alongside us. We're fighting against Morocco and Granada, and of course we had the Morocco and Granada were fighting against Portugal and Castile in that war. Morocco of course had their sort of subjects here, although their subjects I believe are disloyal, but we should just, let's reassess the ecosystem. Let's see what's going on in the world. Let's see what our allies are up to. Let's reassess our relationships. Let's just kind of play it slow here. Kind of like we're just starting off, you know what I mean? We got to check our economy. There's so many things to check. Okay, so we're creating cores, right? We need to create cores on this land so that we can get rid of overextension. Right now we have, if we go to our stability tab, we have 31% overextension. We talked a bit about how this is not good for the unrest of our country, the diplomatic relations with other countries, and also just our ability to do trade and things like that. This is, our nation is so focused on this new land that we're neglecting things, core elements of our country and our economy and things like that. And that's what this is thematically representing, is that while we're still trying to integrate this new land and get it part of the kingdom and try to actually accept these people and set up the rule of law and sort of move the structure of Portugal over to these new areas, then we're kind of like being inefficient with everything else, right? We're focused on the new stuff. And we need to get that done. So that's what this administrative power is doing, right? Using this administrative power to set up that new structure, that new sort of local structure in these areas, and to make this part of our kingdom for now and forever. So that's going to be really, really important. Notice the music's here flaring up a little bit on us. One thing, sorry guys, I think we've kept it a little bit quieter, haven't we, in the past? Actually, really quick, guys, I apologize. Let's just, you got to trust that the music in this game, it might sound quiet at one moment, but it's always going to sort of just spike up on you. Granada is one of the countries that we took land from. We actually, it looks like we have a bunch of lazy diplomats, but we do have a diplomat that is building a spy network in Granada. And they already have 82 spy networks. So we know that we can convert this spy network into claims. We just went to war with Granada. We just took two claims. We had claims on this land. And we took it. There we go. That's what the claims were there for, right? Now we can actually make claims on the next pieces of land. So let's make a claim on this one. And let's make a claim on this one. And this is now 25, right? The first one's 20. The next one's 25. We're just clicking this button right here to fabricate claim. It's a little shortcut. Alternatively, you can always go into here and hit fabricate claim here. We now have a claim. We now have claims on the rest of Granada. And that's because we were building up that spy network during the war. The other thing that spy network was doing for us, right? We mentioned this, I think, maybe briefly, but it was helping us actually win the war by giving us some extra siege ability and some other beneficial things too. So having a spy network against people that you're fighting in war, it makes sense that that would give you an advantage, right? And then right when the war ends, you can swoop in and do what we just did and make claims for a new war. Now we have a truce with these countries. we have a truce here. And it tells you up here as well, the truces that will expire in 1471 with these five different countries. Now, three of those countries are being ruled by Morocco, right? Ruled by Morocco. And then two of those countries are the primary targets, which was Morocco and Granada. So we'll be able to attack those guys in 14 years. 1471, right? So about 14 years from now. However, we have actually, because we've taken Fez and because we've taken this province, we've kind of opened ourselves up into a whole new avenue of conquest. We are now adjacent to a new threat, Tlemcen. Unfortunately, because Aragon has lost land, we noticed that Castile had taken land from Aragon. Because of that, we don't actually have any sort of adjacency to Aragon, right? We were kind of hoping that maybe we could jump into Aragon through this sea tile as a kind of an aggressive move, but we can't quite do that because this is now owned by Castile, who is our good friend, and we don't really want to attack Castile, but it would be nice to beat up on a weakened Aragon, right? Aragon is very weak right now, and Aragon is also very rich. One way we can figure that out is by going to the trade map mode. We can see they own a lot of really good trade provinces, specific trade provinces. These territories that have special icons on them are sort of disproportionately more valuable for trade, right? And Genoa, I think we also noticed earlier, Genoa is a very valuable trade node. There's 17 ducats here up for grabs, whereas in Seville, there's only $6 here. Not nearly as good. Not nearly as good. And if you control Seville and you control Genoa, you can actually be adding those things together, right? You could be pushing this trade down, collecting it down here, making a lot of ducats. I mean, that's way in the future, right? Way in the future. Needless to say, Aragon's got some good land. It would have been nice to take some of it. But either way, we have a new border, a new nation that we're bordering now, which is Tlemcen. What we could do is we could actually start working on them in terms of, you know, working to go to war against them by building up a spy network against Tlemcen. Tlemcen is now a potential enemy. They are still a Sunni heathen like Morocco, like Granada. We could check their alliances and their sort of situations. They're guaranteeing the independence of Mazab. Okay, so if someone attacks Mazab, they'll defend Mazab. And then also they are allied to, they're allied to Castile? They're allied to Castile, which is a problem because we're allied to Castile. And then they're also allied to these guys here. That's actually really, really, really interesting. Why would they be allied to Castile? Probably because these guys are rival to Aragon. And probably Castile is feeling defensive of these guys because they're trying to beat up on Aragon. Let's see if that's kind of true. No, I'm not sure why that is. We've rivaled Tlemcen. No, we haven't. We have not rivaled these guys. They are rival to Morocco. They are rival to Morocco. They are rival to Tunis. They are rival to Granada. Granada should be too weak for them to rival Granada. And because we're adjacent now, they might end up changing their rivalry from Granada. They might lose that, and they might choose to rival us. If they do that, if they rival us, or if we eventually rival them, it might break the alliance between Tlemcen and Castile, because Castile will recognize the fact that they're allied to us and they'd be allied to our rival, and we don't like that. We would tell them that we don't like that, and then they would acknowledge that, hopefully, and break their alliance, because apparently Castile is allied to these guys. Now, it seems weird to me. We could go to their opinion map mode. It seems weird to me that they would actually sort of be in an alliance. It is a defensive alliance. So it's mostly just because improve relations. They spent a lot of time doing the improve relations thing. Different religions is only giving them a minus 10 modifier. It's really not that big of a deal. You got to think eventually Castile's going to want that land down there, right? We go to the diplomatic map mode to kind of see if this was claimed by Castile at all. We haven't even paused the game, right, guys? We're just kind of hanging, we're just chatting, we're just talking about the situation, who's who, what's going on, doing the kind of same things that we were doing initially, right, in the very first episode before we ever played the game. Now we're doing it as a midway through, right? We're not even midway through, but you know what I mean, as we've made progress, right, as we've changed as the borders have been rewritten, as things have actually sort of changed and fluctuated and stuff like that, we're reassessing the situation. Navarra has taken some land on Aragon. Castile took some land there. Aragon lost their personal union over Naples, so Aragon is much weaker, but they are allied to Austria. Austria is a very, very, very powerful ally. We've noticed that before by looking into the ledger, right? And just sort of randomly noticing that Austria is near the top of it. We haven't talked about exactly why Austria is so powerful, but that does go into, I will just say that they're the emperor of the Holy Roman Empire. So they end up getting a lot of power from that. They basically get a lot of power from being the emperor. Sort of all those different members of the HRE sort of contribute a certain amount of money, but then also contribute a certain amount of sort of like force limit or like ability to raise an army, right? Because Austria is in charge of protecting the sanctity of the Holy Roman Empire. So they get a kind of a boost in order to do that, which makes sense. I'm noticing that we took over a lot of forts in here, right? In this land that we took lots of forts. So, and I'm assuming this might be part of the reason why we're losing money all of a sudden. Actually, there's a few things we need to do internally. It says we're losing money. We actually don't have any manpower. I don't even think I was paying attention to this. We got 3,000 men as a deficit. Like our armies are missing 3,000 men to refill the ranks up to 18,000, right? Yeah, we have 18,000 force limit. We only have 15,000 right here. We have no people in the bank. So it's actually going to take a significant amount of time for this to reinforce, because we're only reinforcing 160 per month. Only 160 sort of young men are coming of age to join the army here per month in our small nation. Relatively small nation. We're rooting out a little bit of corruption. That's just sort of something that we need to do to keep this corruption at bay. We haven't talked about corruption in terms of why it's bad, but it makes the cost of technologies go up. So that, in that sense, it's bad. We don't want to pay a penalty on technology, right? We're actually getting a 7% institution penalty. We're probably going to have to talk about that at some point. But I'm just kind of flipping through here, just trying to kind of see what's going on. We don't have any advisors. It would be cool to get some. It would be cool to get some, however, economy, right? We're losing money. How do we fix this? How do we fix this? Well, we could not pay the army. And we'd barely make money. We could look at our navy and try to see what's going on with the navy. Okay, so we could take this light ship, which is not quite repaired yet, and have it protect trade in Seville, and that can add, that ship will automatically rejoin this fleet here that's protecting trade in Seville. That extra light ship hopefully should pay for itself by protecting trade a little bit. We're over the force limit, though. It is worth noting that we are paying a little bit of a premium because we have too many ships, and we can, if we hover here, we can see that we're paying 0.24 because we have too many ships. The other thing we can do with all these other ships, though, is we can actually... that's the thing. These heavies are very expensive. I almost slipped up there, guys. I almost mentioned there is something you can do if you have some of the DLCs. I apologize, guys. There is a sneaky little thing you can do to mothball ships that you're not using and make it so you have to pay them a lot less, which is really neat, kind of like mothballing forts. But that is apparently a DLC feature, a little bit of a bummer there. Usually what you do is you just not pay for your navy, just like you don't pay for your fleet. But I think we need to pay for our navy if we want the to protect trade in the region. Although I don't really know if we're making so much money from protecting trade. Let's see how much money. Let's actually have these guys. Let's cancel these guys. Cancel, cancel, cancel. Cancel mission. Okay, so let's send them all home. And let's see how this number changes. Right now we're making about 3.95. Let's see how that changes. Although this might not have updated for the actual overextension penalty that we're getting, right? There's a huge trade penalty for this. We're just going to have to kind of experiment around to see. But then ideally, like, you know, we would lower the fleet maintenance to save a little bit of money, just a little scooch of money there by doing that. We're paying a huge amount of ducats and forts, right? We're paying 5 ducats for forts. Now this is a very good fort because it's a mountain fort. Very, very good. In fact, actually, what kind of terrain do we have? Speaking of terrain, right, we can look for a simple terrain map mode. And we can see here that we have some different sort of terrain within the Portuguese, main Portuguese area. Looks like this is the only province here that's like a highlands, so that the attackers get a penalty when they attack into this or when they siege forts here. Whereas Lisboa's grasslands. So we don't really get a defensive bonus for having a fort here, unfortunately. The enemy, if they're sitting here and we attack into them, it's kind of like, because it's grasslands, there's not really a penalty being applied there. I'm almost kind of tempted, like, if we were rich, I'd say we could try to move our castle and move it over to here, which would require just destroying it here and building it up there. Castles are very expensive, though. We can go to this button that says you can build in provinces, and we can see that castles down here are 200 ducats. Very expensive. Very expensive. But building one there might be a really good play. It'll sort of protect the capital. and it'll be in a more defensive position. This mountain province down here is great. Now, I'm not expecting to go to war with Castile, you know, super early, super soon, but this province right here, this mountain province, would be a very good defensive position if we ever had to fight Castile. Hopefully, it won't come to that in the short term, right? But eventually, I don't know, maybe we're going to want this land. Maybe we're going to want to make a contiguous connection here between our North African land, our Granadan land, and our main capital. Maybe we'll want a route, a road route. And we'll have to take this land from Castile. It'd be a challenge, but we could do it. So we have Ceuta here, which does have highlands. We have Fez, which is mountains, which is even better. This is, Ceuta also has to do with the straight crossing here, but I think, to be honest, we have three forts here. We don't need all three of these forts. Fez is a very powerful fort in a good sort of centralized area that should block the movement of troops in this entire area. Very large, sprawling province that hits a lot of different individual provinces, creates a huge zone of control. We haven't actually talked about the specifics of forts that much, but these forts essentially emit a zone of control that prevents people from even moving past them. So that's why you can't ignore the forts as an enemy or as an attacker. You have to siege these down because they actually inhibit your ability to move through a nation. As long as there's no forts here, we can move back and forth fighting Castile, but as soon as we want to go up this way, Toledo would block us, or these forts up here would block us. Okay, so by getting rid of a couple of those forts, we're starting to make a little bit of money. We could mothball the other ones, though. However, what I'm thinking is we have rebellion, right? Potential rebellion here and here. So maybe we'll keep those ones online for the rebellion. We could mothball this one, however, which is in our capital. There's no rebellion risk in our capital. It seems like it's 0.0%. So that's fine. We do need to talk about rebellion, right? Because we are going to get some. It is not, we have taken land from another country that belongs to another religion and another culture, and that will rebel. There's not going to be any way around it. We do have a button here that we can hit. We finished a mission. Our mission was to get Tangiers. We did it. Tangiers is an important trade center, and we took it. Fantastic. Our strength in Seville has grown, although it's going to not be, we're not going to feel the full effects until these cores come in and that trade power modifier goes away. That negative trade power modifier goes away. So we've conquered Tangiers. Let's hit the button. We're going to get some administrative power, going to get some prestige, and we're going to get some free claims. So if we go to our claim map mode here, voila, there you go. Bunch of claims right here now. A bunch of reasons to go to war against Morocco. Beautiful. Beautiful. Kind of weird that this province right here isn't, we don't have a claim on that particular province, but we have a claim on all these other provinces down the coast there. So that could be really, really neat. That could be really, really neat, taking that. Bunch of free claims there, very nice. And then that's going to tell us to expand the buffer zone, which basically has us trying to control, basically we need to conquer that land. And then we'll get a, and then that'll get us a sort of another mission. Actually, Portugal's got some interesting stuff in here, I gotta say, even considering the fact that, you know, this is no DLC, right? Portugal's got some unique stuff to play around with, some guidance, right? Which is really important, I think, as a new player to have that guidance. So we have the cores that are coming in. We have a lazy diplomat. We have one diplomat that's working in Tlemcen. We could be working in Morocco to try to finish by getting that province right there claimed, since it's kind of odd that isn't giving us... So we could try to send one to Morocco when we get the chance. We'll have to unpause here to do that. How much money are we making now? Not a lot, because we're still paying a good amount in those forts, and that's because these rebellions are going to rise up. But you know what? The rebellions are still a few years away. I think what we'll do is we'll actually mothball these, because I think I'll show you how the rebellions work, but we will see them coming. We will see those rebellions coming, so we don't have to worry about it too much. We'll be able to turn those online ahead of time. So that's going to make us a little bit more money. If we go to our leaders here, we have one out of three. In fact, we're getting one extra leader, it says here, because we have at least 25 power projection. I'm being a doofus over here, guys. So we have 33 power projection now. That's really, really good. If you have over 25, you get an extra leader without upkeep. We talked about that a little bit, that you have kind of a limit here, right? Usually it's typically just a two as a base, right? And then you can earn more leader slots without penalty. We can go over this number. We can just start training up tons of generals for for military power, right? We can spend our military power to train generals in checking our army tradition. So the higher the army tradition, the better the generals. These ones look like they're going to be 3 to 8 pips as a base. But if we go over this 3, we'll have to pay military power to sustain the extra generals as a monthly cost. So we don't want to go over 3, but it's nice that we can go up to 3. Of course, our king doesn't count. The king doesn't count. And this king isn't particularly impressive, so if he dies, I'm not that worried about it. He's a 3-2-2. Hopefully we'll get somebody a little better here. We do need an heir, though, to be fair. The fact that we don't have an heir is kind of a problem. We have a royal marriage with Castile because we really do want to do that. That gives us a better chance at getting an heir. We could try to make sure that our allies are happy and everything and we have the royal marriages. We could look to someone else to get a royal marriage. Because we have a lazy diplomat right now, right? Lazy diplomat. So who likes us? France? Well, France isn't going to like us because if we click on their diplomacy, we can see they don't like England. We're allied to England. So that's going to be a no-go. It's going to be a no-go. Naples, possibly. In fact, actually, now that they're in a coalition against the Ottomans. Whoa! They're in a coalition against the Ottomans. I wonder how big that is. I think there is a coalition map mode. There it is. So if we click on the Ottomans, we can see that there's a coalition between Moldova, Ragusa, Bosnia, Hungary, and Naples. Venice is capable of joining, and Granada is barely not. So to join a coalition against a nation, you have to have an aggressive expansion modifier of 50 or more. 50 or more. Remember when we took that land down here from Morocco? We ended up getting a bunch of that aggressive expansion. And if we click here, we can see it's 60. We got 60 from Morocco. 60 from Morocco. So that means that's why it said that they would join a coalition against us. They can't because they have a truce with us. They have to wait till this truce ends. And by that point, that number will have decayed, right? That number will have decayed by the time there's a truce with them. But Castile, for example, we only have -8. That's because they like us. They're Christian. They like us. You know, there's no issues there, really. We just conquered a bunch of Sunni land, and they're okay with that. Tlemcen, though, is very upset at -55. They would join a coalition against us, but the thing is, they're the only people that really care. Tunis cares, but not enough to join a coalition. They're only at -31. Mazab really doesn't care. They're too far away to have been affected by that. A lot of these smaller nations here that are ruled under Morocco care, but they're ruled under Morocco, so that they have to follow the same sort of logic as Morocco. So we need manpower. That's actually a big thing. We have these rebellions that are coming up. But the rebellions are still going to be a few years away. We see that one of them is at 10% likelihood of rebelling. 10%. That doesn't mean it's going to happen on a 10% die roll. That means that it's built up 10% progress. It has to get to 100%. So there's a 24% chance of increasing the progress by 10% each month. So every month there's a 25% chance that the rebellion progresses. So we'll see it. When we're not going to worry about this till it gets like 70 or 80%. Because once it gets to 70 or 80%, then it's like a couple months away from happening. Right now, it could be a few years away from happening. In fact, it calculates out that it's probably about 3.2 years away from happening. So we could actually sort of lower the army maintenance right now just to kind of like save a little bit more money. Because I do feel like our economy is the thing that's actually going to sort of throw us for a loop here. We have our dude stationed on Ceuta. There is, let's double check, there's enough supply limit for them on Ceuta. Yes, there is. There's 22 supply limit, and we have 15,000 dudes here, so that's not a problem. And I think for the most part, everything's looking good. Everything's looking good. And guys, we literally just spent an episode just reassessing things, but I think at this point, let's try to get a potential alliance or royal marriage with somebody. I mean, Aragon hates us, right? All these people down here is future conquest. I don't think these guys... No, they've rivaled us. They're not going to get allies. But we could look at, like, Brittany or something. But Brittany's kind of in a spot where France might end up attacking into Brittany. So I don't know if we really want to ally Brittany. I mean, Scotland? I mean, that seems kind of far away and irrelevant. We could at least just try to get a royal marriage with Brittany. They would accept an alliance. What about Burgundy? Burgundy is a pretty powerful nation, even though it looks like they've been beat up by France. France took a few bites out of them. Nope, Burgundy's saying no. That's fine, Burgundy. I didn't want to ally you anyways. I'm tempted to ally Brittany just on the basis I don't want to have a situation where Who is Brittany allied to? England. That's good. If we ally Brittany, they'll be allied to England. England is like a friend of our friend kind of a situation. France is not going to be able to attack Brittany. I think there's even a royal marriage between these two. They have a royal marriage with Brittany. So they're not looking to actually aggressively attack Brittany. They're looking to pursue diplomatic options with Brittany. So I think we actually ally Brittany just to be able to get more royal marriages so that we can increase the likelihood that we can get an heir. Because right now we only have two royal marriages with Castile and England. We cannot get a royal marriage with the Pope because that's a theocracy. And royal marriages, the Pope isn't really one to marry. So there you go. All right, guys. Thank you so much, everybody, for hanging out in this episode. We've kind of balanced the budget a little bit. We've done some other things. We've kind of re-talked about some of the things that we glossed over last time. Our ship should be doing things that are somewhat logical. We are getting close to potentially being able to get new technology that will let us explore the world. And we're also getting to the point where we're going to start to need to think about rebellion. And also we have this sort of mounting modifier for institutions. So the Renaissance has spawned, but we have to think about what does that mean and how is that going to slow us down and how do we fix that problem? How do we embrace the Renaissance, right? We're going to need to embrace the Renaissance. Guys, thank you so much, everybody, for watching this episode. If you guys have questions, please leave them down below. I read every single comment, answer every single question. We got a link to the Discord down below. It's a good place to ask questions as well. Thanks, everybody, for being here. Next episode, I promise we're going to be moving and grooving, and we will be preparing for war against Tlemcen and also working towards those other sort of milestones and working deeper into the Portuguese history here. Thank you so much, everybody. I'll see you guys in the next one.